serve up urban gospel at its best. See you then.
Peace and love, this is your sister Daia, inviting you to tune into First Light and the Gardens of Tranquility and Contemplation every Saturday morning from 6 a.m. until 11 a.m. for great jazz and a soothing meditation, artist interviews, and news that you can use right here at WHCR 90.3 FM, Harlem Community Radio, the voice of Harlem. That's every Saturday morning from 6 a.m. to 11 a.m. on WHCR 90.3 FM, the voice of Harlem.
This is a guided meditation on parenting. Take a deep breath in and let go of the time you and your son played basketball and you attempted to slam dunk. Or when you hit that piñata into your neighbor's yard. Let it go.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. There are thousands of teens in foster care who don't need perfection. They need you. For more information on how you can adopt, visit AdoptUSKids.org. A public service announcement from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, AdoptUSKids, and the Ad Council.
All in together now. We can make it better now. Come on, can we do it?
Yeah, you know that we can.
We'll rope it up.
Cause we know how to jump.
We'll roll it out.
Cause we know how to skate.
We'll cut it down.
Cause we know what to eat.
We'll swap it out.
We eat healthy stuff.
Can we do it?
Yeah, you know that we can.
Can we do it?
Today's a good day to grab your kids and hang out with them for an hour. Dance, walk, play a sport, or cook a healthy meal. Because just moving a little and eating better every day can help make you and your child healthier.
Can we do it?
Yeah, you know that we can.
We'll ball it up.
Cause we know how to hoop.
We'll mess around.
Cause we know how to play.
We'll drop it down.
Cause we know how to dance.
We'll veg it up. Can we do it?
Search We Can online to find doable tips and activities that you can use every day to keep you and your kids healthy. Remember, that's We Can. A message from the Ad Council, HHS, and NIH's We Can program.
You're listening to WHCR 90.3 FM, the voice of Harlem.
The Educational Theater Program at the City College of New York proudly presents the 2014 Family Arts Day, Saturday, May 10th from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. Family Arts Day offers free fun for everyone. There will be theater games, face painting, puppets, sing-alongs, clowns and mask making, live performances, and much more. That's Family Arts Day, Saturday, May 10th from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m., held at Aaron Davis Hall on the campus of the City College of New York at 135th Street and Convent Avenue. For a full schedule of events and directions, visit www.ccny.cuny.edu/edtheater.
Enjoy a red-hot night of music at the world-famous Apollo Theater as Arturo O'Farrell and the Afro-Latin Jazz Orchestra reimagine Chico O'Farrell's Afro-Cuban Jazz Suite in the world premiere of Afro-Latin Jazz Suite. This Harlem Jazz Shrines event will be held on Saturday, May 10th at 8 p.m., featuring performances by Cafe, Freddy Huevito Labaton, Rudras Mahanthpa, DJ Chilo, Logic, and a special tribute to Randy Weston. That's Afro-Latin Jazz Suite on Saturday, May 10th at 8 p.m. at the world-famous Apollo Theater. For tickets and more information, visit www.apollotheater.org.
The first Islamic Film Festival occurs May 3rd through May 4th at the Malcolm X Betty Shabazz Center, 3940 Broadway near 165th Street in Manhattan. For information, 917-946-8903. 917-946-8903. The film festival features Al Ghazali, The Trials of Muhammad Ali, Return to Goree, and 8 Centuries of Islam in America. May 3rd through May 4th. Information 917-946-8903, presented by the Mosque of Islamic Brotherhood Communications Department.
Architect, doctor, maybe an actress, but nothing comes easy. It takes much practice. Like, I met a woman who's becoming a star. She was very beautiful, leaving people in awe. Singing songs, Lena Horne, but the younger version. Hung with the wrong person, got a stronger than her when cocaine, sniffing up drugs, all in her nose. Could have died so young, now looks ugly and old. No fun, cause now when she reaches for hugs, people hold their breath, cause she smells of corrosion and death. Watch the company you keep and the crowd you bring, cause they came to do drugs and you came to sing. So if you're gonna be the best, I'ma tell you how. Put your hand in the air and take the vow. I know I can.
I know I can.
Be what I wanna be.
Be what I wanna be.
If I work hard at it.
If I work hard at it.
I'll be where I wanna be.
I'll be where I wanna be.
I know I can.
I know I can.
Be what I wanna be.
Be what I wanna be.
If I work hard at it.
If I work hard at it.
I'll be where I wanna be.
I'll be where I wanna be.
Be, boys and girls, listen again. This is for grown-looking girls who's only 10. The ones who watch videos and do what they see, as cute as can be, up in the club with fake ID. Careful, for you meet a man with HIV. You can host a TV like Oprah Winfrey. Whatever you decide, be careful, some men be rapists. So act your age, don't pretend to be older than you are. Give yourself time to grow. You're thinking he can give you wealth, but so young boys, you can use a lot of help, you know. You're thinking life's all about smoking weed and ice. You don't wanna be my age and can't read and write, begging different women for a place to sleep at night. Smart boys turn them in and do whatever they wish. If you believe you can achieve, then say it like this. I know I can.
I know I can.
Be what I wanna be.
Be what I wanna be.
If I work hard at it.
If I work hard at it.
I'll be where I wanna be.
I'll be where I wanna be.
I know I can.
I know I can.
Be what I wanna be.
Be what I wanna be.
If I work hard at it.
If I work hard at it.
Yeah, boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, boys and girls, the first-class citizens of the world, the program that you're about to hear, the communicators does not reflect the views, attitudes, whims, these, or any other proclivities of the management of WHCR, nor that of the administration of City College. However, the program does reflect the research done by the participants in the program live in living color in studio by phone interview. And, of course, there is you, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, boys and girls, the first-class citizens of the world. And to God belongs the glory. We thank the Most High for blessing us with another day on this good earth, another day to do some good deeds for ourselves, our families, our communities, and humanity at large. We want to treat everyone the way we want to be treated. And once again, when you do a good deed, the good Lord, if you believe in God, the universe, if you don't believe in God, the universe returns those good deeds at least tenfold. Scripture says one for one evil and 10 for one good deeds. Once again, I'm Brother Leroy, representing the communicator team of Brother Wayne Grice, Brother Lukman Abdul Malik, Brother Senke, and a host of other brothers, including Brother Wali Abdul Noor, Sister Farja, Sister Daya, Sister Sharance, Brother Fahim, and on and on and on and on. We work collectively to bring you a program uplifting of mind, body, and spirit. Today, we're very happy to have with us in studio some young people who reflect what Nas has on that CD, I Know I Can Be What I Want to Be. And we recommend all families, you got big, little children, doesn't matter, you get Nas, I Know I Can Be What I Want to Be, and play that in the morning for your youngsters as they're preparing to go to school or preparing to go down upstairs and get breakfast from somebody where you could have prepared breakfast your own black self. Well, the Learning Tree is a center of learning in the Bronx. It's been in existence for a number of years, run by very conscientious black people. It's an independent school. And one of the aspects of the Learning Tree is that they take the senior class on a international trip every year. In other words, if your child were to go to the Learning Tree in the Bronx, they would be in line for going on a trip. Some go and some don't. But the ones who do go have been to China. They have been to Morocco. They've been to Brazil. They've been to any host of other countries that you and I have not had the opportunity to go beyond 96th Street. And we have a number of those students here today. Brother Elijah Smith, Brother Jordan Drew, Sister Zenu Forster. I'm always chopping up names. And Dr. Gail Forster, who was one of the parents accompanying them. We have two other parents in the studio. They came to watch out for Brother Leroy. They're in the background smiling, etc. We're going to start with the students. Now, and you say, why do I have students on when we deal with political issues? Well, one of the political issues that we deal with is the treatment of black children in the schools in New York City. And very seldom do we have the opportunity of bringing in youngsters who are in an environment run by people who are concerned, sincerely concerned, for their benefits, for their welfare. If you look in the Daily News today, there's an article on cash going into charter schools, and you'll see somebody standing among students, and you say, I don't believe this guy has these two students in line for greatness, but they'll play like that to get money off of our children. But that's another story. So we're going to start with the youngsters in terms of how in the heck did you leave New York City and then take Brother Leroy with you, brother? I've been dying to get out of below 96th Street, brother. Don't even recognize my Metro card. You say, whoa, wait a minute. We're going to start with you, Brother Elijah.
Good morning, everybody.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I didn't prep you all in terms of, I thought you all look at enough BET and MTV stuff to know when a mic is in front of you, run that bad boy. Elijah Smith.
Hi. So in New York, you know, a lot of kids, black kids especially, aren't really treated correctly. And when we went to Africa, we went to two schools in Ghana. We see, like, really how much the kids value their education. Like, a lot of them, after they learn three languages, which a lot of us in New York only learn one.
If you learn that.
America.
If you learn that.
That's very true.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but that's how we learn in school. Yeah, you know, we be interrupting people in class, etc. But I'm sorry.
Yeah, so a lot of them learn three languages. They learn the language that is around them, whether it's tree or whatever. They also get to learn English, and they learn French sometimes. And a lot of them, after school, they study for like 1 to 2 hours, which, knowing me, I really don't study for that long. And it makes me value my education more, know that I really have a lot of things in America that I take for granted, and I need to stop taking it for granted and learn to use it more.
Brother Drew.
Well, a lot of people I know, a lot of African-American students I know do not know anything about Africa at all. They don't know much about their culture and that they came from Africa. They want to deny it. But going to Africa, you know, it was a learning experience because I got to see how we went to two villages, and I got to see how they lived in before. And it was good to see that because not many people get to experience that, and now my eyes are open to many of the problems out there worldwide. I did notice that a lot of them study more than any of us do in maybe my class or the schools across the board. It really makes you want to step up your game, and a lot of them think that the U.S. is a place of opportunity and that they should come here. But, you know, we may not see it as they do. They see it like it's easier to get things done up here, and they could get a job quicker and faster, and we may take a lot of things we have for granted.
Okay, Zanu.
I have been traveling my whole entire life, and every time I did, it has been a great experience. I have learned something new, and I wanted to...
I want you to talk like you're talking to your friend, Tanika. Tanika, give me that money you owe me.
I also wanted to add on to what Elijah was saying about the schools. The second school we went to, we were split up into groups, and in my second group, they were talking about how they have seen different African-American adults come, and they have laughed at them and just not respect them, and how they feel really bad about it, and how when they first saw us, they were scared to come to us because they thought that we would laugh at them too. And I just was so shocked that how could anybody do that to another person that from the same ethnicity. So I just told them, don't pay attention to them. You are what you want to be. You focus on you and don't think about anybody else.
I need you to flesh that out. I'm going to Elijah. Were you in her group?
Oh, no.
No.
Drew, so you were the only one in your group where those students said that about the laughing, the mockery.
Yes.
That was, just flesh that out. What give us a picture of what they gave you.
Well, they were at their school, and other adults walked by, and they were looking at them, and they were laughing, and they were talking to one another about them and pointing. That's the image that I got.
It's kind of, that's okay. It would take, if I were there, unless Dr. Forster has something to add to that, if I were there, I would have, as an adult, I would say, describe them. Let me see what, you know, tell me what they look like. Where were they from? What city? No, not that that was your job to do. I'm just not in that kind of mind frame of that's very interesting. The homework, how do you know that? How was it manifested that they study more? I'm going back to Elijah, Drew, or Zanu. How was it manifested that they study more than, quote, the time you put in? What'd you see? Speak up.
Well, when we was talking to the students, they said they go home and they study for like an average of like 3 hours a day after doing their chores. After their homework, they're still studying until maybe when they go to bed. And a lot of us, we go home, we may do our little chores that we have to do, our homework, and we may study for maybe half an hour and then just watch some TV or just get involved in other things.
Mm-hmm. Were these students younger than you or the same age or older?
Most of them were around were actually older than us. They were in the ninth and upgrades for the first school.
One year beyond you. Zanu?
Well, in African schools, they're split up into how smart you are, not technically your grade or age.
Okay.
So they were the same height as us, but most of them were 18, 19, 17.
So they were behind, or?
They were, you could say that they weren't behind, but they were, they were in the same grade, but they weren't, they were like more intellectually smart, you could say.
Okay, all right. And what did you see? What did you see in terms of, that gave you an appreciation of, you said what you, the opportunities that you have. Yeah, I believe that was you, Elijah.
I'm sorry, so repeat your question.
What did you see that indicated to you that there were opportunities here in the school that you're going to or in the United States that you weren't taking advantage of?
Well, when we was riding around the village, we saw a lot of kids after they came back from school, they had to walk, or even before they went to school, they had to walk miles to go get water because it's not that available in their area. Mm. And then they had to bring it back to the house, and then they had to go do a lot of chores that may have take a lot of time, and then they would still, after they finished all that, they would go and study for like an hour or two.
Mm-hmm.
And I know here, usually after I go home and I do my homework, I kind of just play video games.
Mm-hmm.
Or I'm not really that focused into my education as much as I should mm-hmm. be.
Mm-hmm. So when you, before Zanu has traveled, but Drew and Elijah, how much traveling did you do outside of New York before this trip? And if you went to the Caribbean, you know, what experience did you have in going outside the country?
This was actually my first time going out of the country.
Mm-hmm.
This is also...
Mom said you forgot when... Mom is... The boy don't remember. He was too young. She took him down to the Caribbean. Took him to Mexico. He think that's America. You said it is, right?
No, it's just I don't remember.
The Mexicans
going
know that. He said that. Mexico is another state, boy. Say, wait a minute. That's for real. That's for real. You come up here, they got the same rights that you got. What? You go, don't let me start on that. You go for some... I go for groceries, brother. Everybody got a car swiping through that thing except me. I say, I didn't get a car. I said, damn. I said, what's going on? I know people catching, African Americans catching hell. They can't get a shot of the people going, they swiping the cards. I go to Whole Foods, my people in there swiping cards, you know? But anyway, the what did the trip do for you? When I'm not asking you from the standpoint of an answer for radio, I'm asking, what did it do for you sincerely? I want you to go inside. What did it do for you, Drew?
Well, the trip, it really did open my eyes to a lot of what goes on outside the U.S. because I've never really been traveling. I went out of the U.S. once when I was little, but I can barely remember that. So going to Africa, it helped me to see that things really aren't the same in like how it is in the U.S. And there really isn't, they don't have as much accommodations as we do, and it may be like harder for them to get certain things. So I was just interested to see just a lot of how they Africa was different from the U.S.
And what about the portrayal of the image that some of your friends had of Africa? They made fun. Hey, you going over there, they're going to eat you up and all that other kind of stuff. Threw spears at you. And, I mean, this is the kind of thing they say. You know, you going over there, be black. You know, you're going to come back sunburned and all this other kind of crazy stuff that even I would have said as a young ignorant Negro. But I'm striving. Brother looked at Sister Force. We're ignorant. Coming up, we just don't know. When I was coming up, the image of Africa was portrayed by Tarzan. Tarzan was running through the jungle, swinging on vines, and had a little chipmunk on his, not a chipmunk, but a chimpanzee on his shoulder, and the natives ran when he came. And it was, so that's the image you had of your own people. Meanwhile, they were over there. When I went to Africa, I found them over there, Americans. They over there with jobs, J-O-B-S, businesses. We over here. And so a young person may not immediately relate to what it's done for them, but the impact that it has on you can be far reaching. It can determine what your career is. And I'm talking about a sincere career, what you would like to do that you weren't exposed to before the trip. And Dr. Forster, what were your observations? And share with the audience your background and the fact that you were interested in this trip.
Well, I will share my background and then I'm going to maybe pass the mic. But I'm very interested in creating global citizens. How do we create global citizens? The world today is not the world of even 15 years ago. And our young people are not going to come out of college with a four-year liberal arts degree and just be able to go out there and make it in the career world like they could before. They need second languages and third languages. They need to have global travel experience. They need to be comfortable in other cultures. And they need to expect that they will travel the globe. And what is very special about the Learning Tree and what it does with its middle school students, by the way, the Learning Tree is pre-K through eighth grade. So when you said that these young people are seniors, they're eighth graders. What's special is that they are doing what research says needs to be done. They are exposing pre-collegiate students to the world of travel. Because what happens, what the research shows, is that when our young people go to college and there are travel, study abroad opportunities that they need to take advantage of, they don't go for it. They don't go for it because they don't think of themselves as globe walkers. The people in their community didn't travel the world. The people in their family didn't travel the world. So they don't even go out, and they don't think it's within their reach economically. And when these young people raise the money from their family and from the community, and with community dollars being donated to the Learning Tree to subsidize the trip, it not only enriches them and lets them know this is one of the things I can do in life, but their brothers, their cousins, their neighbors, their peers in the community get to see and expect that global travel is one of the things we do. So that's why this is important. Now, I have to tell you, Brother Leroy, I considered this a half-price trip because instead of having to take my daughter to Ghana, I got to send her with the school. So I didn't go. So I feel like I saved half the fare by not going myself. So that's another reason to send your child to the Learning Tree. They can go and see the world without. And this school has been to Kenya, South Africa. It went to an African village in India last year. One of the few Americans and only young people to visit that African village. Been there since medieval times. Zanu went on that trip also. But my point is that this trip was important, and I wanted to share this with you, but I didn't go on the trip. This brother behind me that I'm going to let sit down in this chair, he was actually on the trip with the students. His son is Elijah, and Elijah, by the way, when he graduates, is going on to Exeter. He's going on to one of the top schools in the country. So the Learning Tree also sends our young people off into the world, comfortable and confident. Imagine this young brother at Exeter, okay? Clear about who he is.
People don't know where Exeter is. Is that in Massachusetts?
Exeter is in
New Hampshire.
And it is one of the top prep schools in the world. Okay? And these other young people sitting next to us are also going to very good schools. But the point is, they will go to these schools, whether they're predominantly white, predominantly wealthy, predominantly anything, and they will be clear about who they are because of the school that Sister Lois Gregory founded in the Bronx that has this mission.
And this is WHCR 90.3 on the FM dial, and you can plug in. We only have a few more minutes with our guests here in studio, students and older students. My brother Smith, he went on this trip. This is a program that even younger people listen to, and wow, we have one right on the line.
You're listening to WHCR 90.3 FM, the Voice of Harlem.
Telephone number 212-650-6903, 212-650-6903. If you care to interact with the students, ask a question, please. Ask a question, please. Ask a question. If you go into speeches and stuff like that, I'm cutting you off. And you don't know what I get up in here. Get the Constitution, the Amendment, the 88th Amendment. Well, that ain't been passed yet. Yeah, but I heard somebody talk about radio, or 88th Amendment. Brother Smith, your full name?
Reginald Smith.
And you snuck on this trip, right?
Yes, I did.
You wanted to make sure your son wasn't going to be eaten by these natives over there?
No.
Well, baby, I'm going to see. I'm taking my vacation time. I'm going over there. I'm going to take my son. This is my son.
Actually, this was my second trip.
Oh, sweat.
I had the opportunity in 2008 to travel with my oldest son, Malik Smith.
Wait a minute. That's a tribe called Quest, brother. Y'all doing nothing but traveling up in here. Your oldest, where's he at?
He's home at the moment. When you say where he's at?
School.
Oh, he's attending.
He got so many children, he don't know where school
City,
he
went. New York City Tech.
Yeah, his wife.
At a moment, I'm sorry.
Brother, say amen. I ain't never been all back before, brother. I forget everything. Where do you live? Wait a minute, Elijah, where we live? How did we get it? Did you drive with me? Brother Smith, yes. Boy, brother. Talk to us about this trip real quick.
Well, I think observing the kids, our children had the opportunity as they spoke to interact with kids from Africa. Mm-hmm. And they had a chance to share their experiences. Some of the things that I noticed from the feedback that I received were their perception of us. And maybe some of the kids can talk about it, but they also had a negative perception of our president because of a lot of the misinformation that was given out. They also had the opportunity to visit a slave dungeon.
Mm-hmm.
They had another opportunity to visit a place called the Last Bat. And
the Last
Bat.
B-A-T?
H.
Go ahead. B-A-T-H.
Yes.
Okay, batch.
No, bath.
Bath.
Yeah,
the bath. Last bath.
Yes.
That we took before getting on the boat.
Yes. Yes. Man. And so, maybe at the moment they're not able to articulate, but I think as they move throughout their careers and move mm-hmm. further, they'll be able to reach back. And, you know, the experience Elijah had where we were in one of the art crafts, looking at different things maybe to purchase or bring back, and someone came up and said to him, Elijah,
he stuck out his fist to give me a pound. So when I went to give him a pound, he said, what's up my n-word champion?
Mm-hmm. My nigger champion.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What's up my nigger champion? That was supposed to get you to buy more grips from him or something.
Well,
no, I mean that's what they be thinking. Well, how was he wearing his clothes?
Well, he wasn't sagging at anything, but, like, I guess it's because of, like, what they see on TV and their perception of America. Like, when they see all these music videos
yeah.
and they hear all these curses and they think, oh, that's what they,
right.
that's what we use.
Right.
That's why he used that,
right.
In that sense.
Right. Man. It's not a surprise. I mean, if you went to China, they'd do the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
If you went to the right place.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's just the way it is. When I say it's just the way it is, I'm saying that from the standpoint, that's the condition that we have to correct. That's the condition that we have to correct. And a lot of them come over here and have that same attitude when you find them, some of the younger ones selling you items on the street, or they just blend in. And a lot of our African young brothers and sisters are finding themselves in jail here in New York City because they've veered into the lifestyle that's portrayed in video and whatnot. I'm going to the students. What was your feelings, if you had any perceptible feelings that you had went into the slave dungeon? Do they call it a castle? They call it a castle.
Yes. Well, the slave dungeon there was definitely different from all the slave dungeons that I went to in America. When we went there, like, it was very, I felt sad when we went into, when we went into the slave dungeon and we saw how many, we heard about how many people was kept in a little room and they would have, like, very limited air holes for the people
yeah,
to stay alive.
Yeah.
And, when we went to the door of no return, that was really sad to even just think about like how our ancestors were treated. But then I felt a little bit relieved when we was coming back through that door.
Mm-hmm.
On the other side it said the door of return, as in that we have returned, fulfilling what our ancestors actually
mm-hmm.
wanted.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah.
Mm-hmm. And Zanu?
For me, I was mostly thinking that could have been me in the slave dungeon. I could have been stuffed in there with 400 people and not been able to move and having to pee and poop in the same spot that I am for however long I'm there. And that thought just, it just really corrupted my brain. I could not, it made me really sad.
And Drew?
It was disheartening to see and hear about how they were mistreated and they were just stuffed in there like animals. They were just pushed like to the back of a closet, like old dirty shoes you put there, and they just left them there and they didn't give them proper accommodation. So I felt it was crazy to see that, because I couldn't imagine myself in that situation. I wouldn't have survived, because I can't take that type of oppression.
You went to Turkey after?
Before
Turkey was, how long were you in Turkey?
One day.
Yeah. What did you see or what did you pick up, if anything?
Istanbul.
What did you see? What did you pick up?
For me,
could have said, I got a soda and I got a sandwich.
For me, we went to Istanbul. We went into this, it was kind of like a castle, but it was
a mosque,
yeah. And inside there were paintings and there were gold statues, and it was just really elegant and amazing inside, and it just really showed that these people actually know to respect their religion, and that just gave me a lot of honor.
Question, in at the Learning Tree, one of the courses that you're exposed to is entrepreneurship and gardening. And gardening is related to hands-on, gardening is related to agriculture. What, if anything, did you make a connection between what you had in school and what you saw over there, opportunities, etc.? Maybe you didn't see anything. I mean, tell me. See, the way you deal with this. I didn't see anything. I saw this. I saw that.
Well, we got to see how they made the shea butter. Naturally, they made it from the shea butter nut. It was a nut, right? Yeah. And it was an interesting process to see, because I know a lot of us use shea butter for multiple different things.
Mm-hmm.
They probably use it for more things than we could even imagine.
Mm-hmm.
And I know some of us bought some, and I would like to, it would be nice to see like an experiment with that process, maybe in our gardening class.
I didn't know where shea butter come from. I never asked. I just see them with the big things, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And you saw them, how did they process the nut?
Well, they took the nut and they put it through a grinder, and they grind it into like a powder. They dried it in the sun, and then they grinded it again until it became like a paste. And then once that happened, it was like a dark chocolate color.
Yeah.
And usually, you know how the shea butter is like really light,
right?
Like a lightish yellow. So what happens is they put warm water into like a big jug of the shea butter paste,
mm-hmm.
and the water, the bad parts of it comes to the bottom, and then the shea butter rises to the mm-hmm. top, and you take that off, and then you would put it into another big container,
mm-hmm.
and then you would do that once more, and then you would boil it. They said they boiled it three times, twice.
That's how, when they boiled it, that's when all the dirt went to the bottom, and then that's when they would take the it would start to get lighter as you go on, and eventually you get the yellow color.
So y'all some scientists up in here. I wouldn't have got that far. I say, well, they did this, and then, you know, that's great. That is great. Telephone number 212-650-6903. We're about to conclude with these young students, and put your earphones on so we can hear what your question. God bless you on the air.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. My question is to everyone, blessings. Did you draw any correlation between what is taught in the Americas and what the rite of passage you now have at your disposal and your responsibility to that. Did you?
I need you to be clear on your question, brother.
There is an understanding of rite of passage wherein you take the youth and you present them with what the ancestors went through. In the history books of the Americas, did these children have any way that they drew a correlation between what was taught in history here in the Americas and what they experienced personally in Africa? Is that good?
Okay. All right. Thank you for your call.
At the learning tree.
No. Students. Sorry. I'm dealing with the students. What correlation? Did you draw any correlation? Yes or no?
Yes, I think. Because when we were at the school and we were talking with the children, a lot of them actually did know a little bit about our history, and they knew about, like, slavery, which some people didn't think they knew. Didn't think the Africans knew about slavery and what really happened to them, but they actually did, so...
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Let me see. We got some more calls on the air. God bless you. Thank you for your call. You're on the Black Air.
Oh, Assalamu alaikum, Brother Leroy.
Walaikum salam.
Okay. I'd like to ask him about the math over there at this, they learn over there. Is it more advanced over there in Africa than what they learn here in America? And they can explain on that?
Okay. Thank you, my brother.
When we were at the school, I was talking to some of the students, and most of them wanted to become scientists and engineers and doctors, and most of their classrooms were science classrooms. They had a lot of labs, so most of them wanted to influence in that career.
Okay. How did that impress you? Or
For me, since I know most of the students here want to become dancers or
okay.
singers.
Okay, you answered the question, sis. We're going back to the videotape. That's not to cut you off. I mean, you know, most of them want to be dancers. They want to be on radio. They want to do stuff. These people that you saw over there want to be creators.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where their mindset is. So that's why I said you answered the question. God bless you on the Black Air.
Sharon Barry, Brother Leroy, how you doing?
Black as ever.
Yes, sir. What I want to ask the students is, now that they went to Africa, what can they take from there to use here that we don't have here that they need there?
Okay, we'll let them answer. Thank you for your call. Did you understand the question?
No.
Okay. I understood the question, but I didn't write it down. Brother Barry, you're going to have to call right back so that we can get the benefit of your... I'll let you stay on the line while you ask the question. 212-650-6903. This is The Communicators. And let me see if we got Black Barry. God bless you.
Yes, Brother Barry again.
Okay. Go with your question again, brother.
Okay. The question was, being that you went to Africa, what is it that you can use from America to take there that they don't have there that we have here?
Okay, hold on while they respond. Let's see that your question is clear, okay?
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So when we went to, I believe it was Tebele, which was a country, was a village in Burkina Faso, we realized that, like, a lot of them didn't really have water. So when we was on the tour bus and we was riding away, our principal has said we might want to build a well there. Although they said it would cost $10,000, it would be helpful for them. So we would like to build a well there.
Zanu?
I was going to say the same thing.
Okay. Drew?
There. I agree.
Okay. All right. All right, Sean. You got that. Thank you, my brother.
Yes, sir.
And got time for one more question. 212-650-6903. And... the Learning Tree, Brother Smith, where's the Learning Tree at?
Learning Tree is located in the Bronx, one block from Evander Childs High School.
801
Bartholdi
Avenue. But that is magenta up there? Is that yes. That's a, yes. I'm gonna say magenta, man. That was hard for me to find that school, but it's behind Evander Childs.
Yes, it is.
If you can find Evander Childs, it's behind Evander Childs. So what do you mean by that? There's a parking lot behind Evander Childs, and the school is right across from the parking lot, adjacent to the soccer field. And yes. Let me see. The telephone number is 718-944-0958. Wait a minute. Okay. All right. Is this the right number for the school or yours? That's the right number. 718-944-0958. 718-944-0958. We're going to shift for a moment and go to opportunities in private high schools, and we want Sister Forster to give us a breakdown on the opportunities that are developing there. Watch your head on that speaker. And once again, this is the communicators, and the fact that these children have gone to on a trip abroad is something that we can begin to do within our own families. And the value of traveling is beyond what any individual can say. You know, they can say, I was there. But if you have that kind of globalization in mind, especially black children, because wherever the European went, when they escaped from Europe, they found black people. Whether they were looking like Indians or whether they went to the North Pole, they found Eskimos there. Wherever they went to China, there's a group of black people there. They go to Japan, there's a group of black people there. They go to India, there's a group of black people there. Wherever the European went, and especially into the South Pacific, Guinea, the South Pacific, they found us. So why shouldn't we endeavor to have our children travel abroad and see what they can see about the world and the opportunities that exist? And these youngsters have come back with a notion of how other students study. They know that three languages is, you know, it's not even a do you want to take them, that you got to take them. English, French, maybe Arabic, some other language, German. They come over here. The youngsters who come out of Africa, they are well prepared, even though they may not be in the position in schools, they are well prepared. Sister Gail Forster, opportunities in private high schools.
Yeah.
What is that?
Well, you know, there are historically black independent schools, and that's what the Learning Tree is. And you remember I used to do a lot of work with those schools. There were about 90 of them in New York City. Most of them only go up to either sixth grade or eighth grade. After that, parents need to make another choice about a high school. What a historically black independent school does is it lays the foundation so that your child can confidently go to a school that might be predominantly white, that might be predominantly upper class, and succeed because they have that clear foundation as to who they are. So we send a lot of our schools students at the Learning Tree. A lot of the students go on to private high schools, but it's become so much more competitive than it ever was before. Even the public high schools, how many of you know that only 7 black students got into Bronx Science this year? 7, citywide. Now, you know that wasn't the case a few years ago.
And only way we're going to solve that is solve it.
So this is how we're going to solve it. On Wednesday, May 14th, okay, from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m., if you have a 5th grader, a 6th grader, a 7th grader, even an 8th grader, if you have a 3rd or 4th grader, you should be there because there's going to be a workshop at the Learning Tree on opportunities in private high schools. And there's going to be a recruiter there, especially for boys of color to attend private high schools in the city and boarding schools. We have 2 young people sitting at this desk who are accepted into boarding schools, New England boarding schools. The topics that will be covered are independent school placement programs, financial aid for working as well as unemployed parents, student and staff diversity at independent schools, how to create a portfolio of your best fit schools. Too many of our parents are not applying to a range of schools that assures that they at least get into one with the financial aid that they need. Why boarding schools are an excellent option.
the value and power of single gender schools. There is power in all girls and all boys schools, just like there are there's power in Afrocentric schools, in Jewish schools, when you affirm the gender, when you affirm the ethnicity in young people. It gives them a space to express themselves more fully than in a more different kind of competitive environment. And so the Learning Tree is doing this on Wednesday, May 14th. It's open to the public. We ask, and there's no admission fee if you will email us before the event. There's absolutely no admissions fee. And the school is located near White Plains and Gun Hill, as we said, behind Vander Charles High School. And the phone number again is 718-944-0958. And you can email me, drforster@tltprep.org. That's drforster at tltprep.org.
What's that train that stops nearest?
Two train.
That's the two.
Uh-huh. The two train. The five is sometimes goes to White Plains, sometimes it goes further down on Gun Hill, then you get off and take a bus. But the
that's
two,
the one way over? Yeah, which one is way over? The five is way
right.
Way over.
Right.
That's Leroy's train. I say I know it's but Leroy get lost.
Well, it's be on the two, get off it at Gun Hill Road, and then you walk towards Evander Child. It's behind Evander Child. And can I make one more pitch for the
yes.
school?
Yes.
This school is facing a financial crisis this year. It has to raise $60,000 by July. We need people to support the school. They can support it by sending a donation, going to our website. The website is learningtreeprep.org, learningtreeprep.org. They can buy a journal ad in our journal coming up in June. They can make a donation to the silent auction. They can bid on silent auction, online silent auction items. But we need the community to come through. The school's been around 30 years, and there's no reason it should close its doors when we have a community out there that values it.
It's not only a safe environment, the school, but it's a learning environment. And many of our people are putting their children into charter schools that have a, quote, safe environment, but the environment of learning and the self-identity with black people is left to be much desired. We're going to launch your question. God bless you on the air.
Yeah, it's fine. God bless you. And let me turn this down. And I want to speak to the young lady that just spoke. What happened years ago when we had the Color Guard, the cadets, the Boy Scouts, the PAL, YWCA? You know, if you go in the PAL, they won't even let you drink water. Our community, and it's sad to say it, we have to just not look for the charter schools because it used to be the annexes. They have got to take back control. It's not. I applaud children going abroad, and I've watched certain children grow and progress through these programs. But what saddens me is that we put our power behind a salon, makeup, and looking to be a Kardashian runaway bride and all that eyelash and fantasy world when they are wearing miniature skirts and like kiddie porn and all this stuff, and then the kids are emulating. We have to take it back. They've stolen from us for centuries and still do it.
Okay, caller.
Yes,
caller. I need you to be on point because you're covering. First of all, because I'm only dealing with time.
Uh-huh.
That you are bringing up very important points, and I want to make clear to you and the rest of the audience, the Learning Tree is not a charter school.
Uh-huh.
I mentioned that in the context of the Learning Tree being a learning environment.
I understand that.
Okay, and you're bringing up the issue. With the uniform.
The issue is not so much in the uniform, mm-hmm. it's in the respect of what she's saying, because it used to be annexed and split off of certain things. I'm not, and all education is a good thing, and especially traveling. We have to stand up and demand our refund, not be just a dollar increase in a stamp, but our kids' future. They have robbed us blind and robbed the kids, and it's continuing. And the war shouldn't be amongst us. We should be united and stand together, let them know. This is not a proposal that's going to end when they come around to it after more billions of dollars are throwing good money after bad and give us the crumbs. We want our kids' dignity back, our pride back, and take the colloquialism out the street and put the correct language in the homes. And I applaud all these people with these programs that they're coming for. But I would like to see it change. I would like to see us stand together.
Okay. All right. Thank you for your call, my sister.
Thank you.
Can I make one statement about...
Wait a minute. Go ahead.
I just want to make one statement about historically black independent schools. They represent the community coming together. This school isn't getting grants from anywhere. It's not It survives by community support. Tuition is only $600 a month. Where can you get this much for $600 a month? Now, of course, some people can't afford that $600. But for those struggling parents who find a way, and grandparents and families who find a way to do it, it represents us taking control of the education of our children and assuring that it is an affirming one. It has a strong math program. We have one of the strongest math programs in the Bronx. We have a strong arts program. In the citywide, there's no stronger arts program. The children are taking ballet and African dance from kindergarten. This school is doing what we say we need to stand together and do. So what we need to do is stand together around this school.
All right. And as we conclude, first of all, give that telephone number for the event that's coming up May 14th.
718-944-0958. And it's drforster@tltprep.org in order to RSVP.
And folks who do not have any children but would want to donate, and for those who do have children would donate, then that telephone number would be the same thing to get the details on how you can contribute to the upkeep of the school.
718-944-0958, or go to our website, learningtreeprep.org. And the event is Wednesday, May 14th, 6 p.m. to 8 p.m.
And for the students, concluding remarks, what I'd like for you to do is think in terms of, based on your trip, what you would recommend to fellow students out there. Based on your trip, based on that experience, what would you recommend to students, families of students who are listening?
I would like to say that before I went on this trip to Africa, I watched the news and I see so many African poor people just lying around on the dirt floors. And I would just like to let the young people out there know that not all African people do that. They are very rich in other things despite money. They're rich in their respect to nature and their community. So just don't always believe things that you hear on the news.
I would just like to let people know to stay open to opportunities and take your education seriously, because there you have a great opportunity and you don't want to waste it.
I would say that don't always focus on like how much money that you have, because no matter what, like, there's always an opportunity that can help you in the future that you need to just bounce on and, like, take the most of it.
And, Brother Smith, in terms of your recommendations to the parents out there.
You will not find a better school anywhere in New York City than Learning Tree Prep.
Okay. And once again, ladies and gentlemen, that telephone number is 718-944-0958, and of course you hear this kind of programming on the Communicators. Thank you very much for joining us. God bless you. Thank you, Sister Smith. You were in the background coaching. Hey, wait a minute. I tell you, ain't nothing like having a better half, brother. I'm telling you.
Yes, I agree.
All right, God bless you all. Wait a minute. We got one. Thought we had one call up in here. Folks wanted to get their.
You're listening to WHCR 90.3 FM, the Voice of Harlem.
All right, that caller. If you, I'm gonna give you the benefit of calling, making that last call, 212-650-6903 before we leave the air, and with the students from the Learning Tree in the Bronx. And you got 3 seconds to call, and okay. Let's go with Brother Nas.
Smells of corrosion and death. Watch the company you keep and the crowd you bring. Cause they came to do drugs and you came to sing. So if you're gonna be the best, I'ma tell you how. Put your hand in the air and take the vow. I know I can.
I know I can.
Be what I wanna be.
Be what I wanna be.
If I work hard at it.
If I work hard at it.
I'll be where I wanna be. Boys and girls, listen again. This is for grown-looking girls who's only 10. The ones who watch videos and do what they see. As cute as can be, up in the club with fake ID. Careful, before you meet a man with HIV. You can host a TV like Oprah Winfrey. Whatever you decide, be careful, some men be rapists, so act your age, don't pretend to be older than you are. Give yourself time to grow. You're thinking he can give you wealth, but so young boys, you can use a lot of help, you know. You're thinking life's all about smoking weed and ice. You don't wanna be my age and can't read and write. Begging different women for a place to sleep at night. Smart boys turn them in and do whatever they wish. If you believe you can achieve, then say it like this. I know I can.
I know I can.
Be what I wanna be.
Be what I wanna be.
If I work hard at it.
If I work hard at it. I'll
be where I wanna be.
I'll be where I wanna
now,
be.
Now, go.
I know I can.
I know I can.
Be what I wanna be. Be what I wanna be. If I work hard at it. If I work hard at it. I'll be where I wanna be. I'll be where I wanna be.
Be. Before we came to this country, we were kings and queens, never porch monkeys. There was empires in Africa called Kush, Timbuktu, where every race came to get books to learn from black teachers who taught Greeks and Romans, Asian Arabs, and gave them gold. When gold was converted to money, it all changed. Money then became empowerment for Europeans. The Persian military invaded, they heard about the gold, the teachings, and everything sacred.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we're Black in Line and continuing with current events. There is in the small city of Benton Harbor in Michigan something going on that is way beyond our comprehension as far as could this really be happening in America. It is not in the South. It's in the North, as far north as you can go in Michigan. And we have online a brother who is he can tell you firsthand what's going on. Reverend Pinckney, God bless you. Thank you for joining us on the Communicators.
Leroy, thank you so much just for having me. I tell you, it's a pleasure, and I just love the work that you do. You are a tremendous character, and I tell you, I wish we had a million of Leroy's running around here.
Hey, listen, don't get me in more trouble than what I'm in, all right?
Oh, I know the feel. When you're out here working, they come looking for you.
You better believe it. Share with us, tell us the significance of Benton Harbor real quick. We only have a few minutes.
Okay,
and the vacuum.
By water.
Okay, go ahead.
And Whirlpool Corporation controls this area. What they're trying to do is drive all the African Americans completely out of the community. Gentrification is a word that's used to describe exactly what's happening here. But on the other front, which is even more important than that, is that I've been fighting them. Matter of fact, we almost had Whirlpool in such a compromised position that they was almost about to be junk stock. But to jump ahead, because I know we don't have a whole lot of time, on April 24th, I was taking my wife out to dinner. It was her birthday, an early dinner. And before we can get to our destination, we found out that the sheriff's department, the SWAT team, more than 30 law enforcement agents had surrounded my home. They had decided, I guess, they didn't break the door down and come in or anything like that, but they was all in, they blocked off the streets, they did everything, trying to find me. They was going all over the city, trying to locate me. Here's the problem. I went to my attorney, and he called the prosecutor office and told the prosecutor department, you're harassing Reverend Pinckney again. Is that correct? And they said they had a warrant for my arrest. They said they had a recall. We had a recall of the mayor. We were successful in recalling the mayor. And unfortunately, what happened was the mayor he happened to be an African-American. He promotes the corporation agenda. And that's what he does. So they trying to put their arms around him to protect him. This is what it's all about. So anyway, they said that they had a warrant for my arrest and charged me with 5 felonies of changing the date on a petition. So even make things even worse, we was going to surrender on Monday, but the chair of the department, everybody said no. They wanted me right then and there. But we decided we weren't going to go in right then and there. We waited until the next morning when I surrendered to the court. They had set bond for me at $30,000 cash. Once I went before the judge, he said that I have to be on house arrest 24/7. He didn't want me out in the streets. He don't want me around people. He don't want me doing anything. Also, I could not be on the computer. He said, if I'm on the computer, then I will be in violation of my bond. So, no computer, no outdoors, no nothing, trying to silence the voice of the people. And what makes it even worse than that, they're fighting on a whole different level. They're trying to stop us, and they're using black folks. They're using black folks to oppress other black people. And they got them where they want them. And nobody is saying something, even with the NAACP and other things that we know who they are. But the point is, we have to stand up and fight these folks, show these people what we're all about, and deal with these people.
Now, Reverend Pinckney, the allegation of making a change on a petition, that is a, what they're saying, that's a felony charge.
Yes.
That's not the sheriff or the marshal coming to your door and saying what the charge is or going to your lawyer and telling you to come in. This is an opportunity to demonstrate a militaristic presence in the black community. Is that what you're saying?
Absolutely. Matter of fact, it was martial law, because what they did, they blocked the streets off. You couldn't enter your home and you couldn't come out your home. The people that was not under surveillance, but you know, they say you can't come out for any reason. Right now, we got snipers, we got everybody out here. We don't want you out in the streets. Don't come out your house.
So this is the same thing that they did in Boston after the so-called Boston bombing. And I say the so-called Boston bombing, something happened up there. But according to alternative media, they said it wasn't the way those people, the common belief has been projected. So I'm not going to get into that, but that's the same thing where they shut down that area where they were going to get the guy that wound up being in a boat.
Absolutely, absolutely. And that's the mentality now of the law enforcement now. They want to show force. And here I am, a guy, a Nick over 5'7", and, you know, pretty humble guy, 65 years of age. There's not too much I want to, I don't want to shoot it out with them, but I guess they saw the movie Scarface when he said, you want to meet my little friend, and that's probably, they came with so much force. So it's a lot of stuff that's happening here that people don't understand, but it's not just here in Benton Harbor. It's all over the country. This is what they're doing to intimidate the people. You know, it's really a terrorist attack. That's what that was.
Now, listen, was there a period of time where people did not know where you were when you were under arrest after you surrendered to them?
No. They were searching for me all that day and night, and the law enforcement could not find me. That's when most people knew where I was. And I didn't go in and surrender till the next day with me and my attorney. So, you know, it went very smooth. We had the bonds in there. We had everything in order. We were prepared, you know, to take it to the next level. So we were pretty well organized for the occasion at that time. So, but the thing was, they were the one trying to locate me, and they couldn't find me. So they made a big deal out of it. Newspaper, we can't find Pinckney. Pinckney can't be found. That's all front page headlines.
Now listen, you know? this is equivalent to the guy on the Clippers. They make that the front headline for a few days. They sell more papers. Where's Pinckney?
Yeah, he's where's Pinckney? And look, from Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, my picture was on the front page.
This is amazing, brother. Now, listen, just give us a flavor of this Benton Harbor now. And the guy who is the mayor, was he elected or was he appointed by the governor?
He was elected. He was elected by the people. Matter of fact, even that sign scene was a little shady, but he was elected. He asked me, so I got to give him his dues. He was put in office. People had no idea that he was the way he was, strictly against the people. anytime you for a corporation and against the people, we have a problem with that. And what he was doing, he was giving away, was signing off on land that didn't rightly belong to him, but belongs to the city. But he had to have his signature on it because he was the mayor.
Mm.
So that's what he was doing, and we decided we were going to recall him. But when they don't want someone recall, they know what to do. They go out and get people to do things and make sure that, you know, if they have to bring you in, they'll bring you in on charges
now,
if
brother,
they can.
Brother Pinckney, they for this petition thing, you live in Benton Harbor.
That is correct.
Okay, and for this petition thing, the allegation is a felony, and you made the bond of $30,000 cash.
Yes.
And then when you make the bond, then they put you under house arrest?
Then they put you back under arrest, house arrest now.
Now, listen, you got to laugh to keep from crying.
Right, absolutely. You hit the nail right on. You got to laugh to keep from crying about this crap. And here it is. It's a nonviolent offense. It's only signatures. This is what, you know, what the deal is. $30,000 for some signatures makes no sense at all.
And
there's no logic to it.
It's an allegation.
That's all it is, allegation.
Now, is it changing signatures or changing a date on the petition?
Changing a date, according to them.
So it's not even forging somebody's
no.
Somebody in the graveyard, you know.
Absolutely, it's not even that. it's about as weird as you can get. And they brought in a forensic. The guy claimed, and he was. Look, you were mad. They said, well, it got to be right because he's a forensic. He's wrong. He's wrong. He's 100% wrong. But yet and still, they using that, you know. Well, you know, he got to be right because he's a scientist. They said it happened, but he don't know who did it.
Now, let's conclude our short interview with you with what should the public be looking at in general? When you step back,
mm-hmm.
and you take a look at your experience and beyond, what should a black audience be about?
Well, you know what? We should be about taking care of our children and the future of our children. Everything should be about the future. We should be preparing ourselves for the future because that's where we have failed the next generation because we didn't do what we're supposed to do. We're in a very compromising position today because we have failed to do the things that need to be done. And most of the time when we don't do the things that need to be done, this is what's happening. They're killing our children. They're not educating our children anymore because they figure that, you know, that we're a dying species because we're killing each other. We're killing each other. There's no jobs available for us. Automation have taken the place of so many things. So what we need to do is now stop preparing for the future of our children. That's the fight. It's all about our children. It's not about Reverend Pinckney. It's not about Leroy. It's about the future of our children. Once we get that in our head, maybe then we'll come together and fight as a unit and start trying to be individuals. It's not about you. That's what our message should be.
Reverend Pinckney, how do people follow the story out of Benton Harbor?
You can go to bhbanco.org. That's bhbanco, BANCO.org. Or you can call me at 269-925-0001. That's 269-925-0001. And listen, if you go to my website, we got a button there. If you wish to donate to my legal defense fund, you're welcome to do it because we need all the revenue we can get. Because this is going to be one fight that we almost must win.
All right. I mean, almost ain't in the question. I mean,
that's right.
It's one thing. It's one thing about Negroes going into corporate America. They go in to just play the game of tennis. The guys they're playing against are going in to crush them.
Mm-hmm.
Even at outings, corporate outings, these guys
mm-hmm.
play all out. I was watching when I was in corporate America how these guys play all out. It was supposed to be fun and games, man.
Yeah,
they were playing all out, and that's what you're dealing with. You're not dealing
Absolutely.
With somebody want to harass you. They actually want to take you out of the game.
Absolutely, that's their plan.
All right, my brother. Thank you.
Appreciate you too, Leroy.
All right.
Anytime.
God bless you.
God bless you too, and thanks.
Billy Paul, coming black at you. This is The Communicators, and without further delay, ladies and gentlemen, moving on to the next segment. Right after the next segment, we're going to Brother Dick Gregory, but this segment, we're going to Brother Robert. We're continuing our dialogue on marijuana. Many of you are growing marijuana in your backyards, and you're up on the roof, in the tub, and everything else. You all think this bad boy is going to be legalized. And y'all gonna get ahead of the game, but Brother Robert has some insights for you. God bless you. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam, brother, to you and the audience, and my brother Dick. Pleasure being in the community with him.
And Brother Robert, last week we had Dr. Hooker, Donald Hooker in Atlanta. He's a natural healer, and he was sharing some things about marijuana on the negative side, and many of the people were, it was new to many of our audience because they haven't heard negatives regarding cannabis, marijuana, simply because they are getting ready for a all-out corporate push to make marijuana legal in the U.S. What is your research, new research that you've been able to do?
Well, my research lets me know that marijuana causes you to drop out of society. Listen to this, brother. Sesamelia was one of the most famous brands of marijuana. They call it just plain ses. It's a Spanish word meaning without seeds. Sesamelia is developed by not allowing the female plant to be pollinated by the male, thus making the plant more potent. Deprived of the pollen, the female plants excrete more resin in an attempt to pick up any pollen that may be present in the air. This method was developed by the hippies. I'm going to repeat that. Very important. This method was developed by the hippies. of the 1970s, and it's very dangerous to smoke because of the unbalanced nature. The natural development of the plant has been tampered with, making the plant more dangerous. Its use has a negative effect on the brain and the entire body, physically, mentally, and spiritually. Now, for us that were here in the 70s, it caused the hippies to drop out. A lot of them were wealthy. A lot of them come from pretty decent educational backgrounds, and they totally dropped out. They dropped out of the society, became non-productive. From Sesamelia, they went into LSD, Purple Haze, and Peyote. And this is what they want to do to black and Latinos. This is much worse than crack cocaine and what it did to us in the 80s, because now we have four or five generations, at least three, of being promoted. They call it social promotions. That means if you get left back, you go to the next grade. Now they want somebody who's mentally dead that can have as much as an ounce of weed that's been sprayed with formaldehyde, which is an embalming fluid, elephant tranquilizer, and any psychotropic medication. You can spray weed with Thorazine. You can spray weed with Lopressa. You can spray weed with Risperdal and any other chemical component that we know can damage the individual, because you now have, you have chemicals now. If they get this pill inside your body, it causes you to be paranoid. They have another pill that can make you over-aggressive. They even have a pill that they put in the regular medication that can give you suicidal tendencies, where you'll damage yourself or damage someone else. So that's another trick that the tricknologists are practicing on the mentally dead and unsuspecting.
The going back to that Sesamelia.
Yes, sir.
That's the pronunciation. Sesamelia. What is your readings on the impact of the sexual capabilities of the male taking in that kind of drug? They don't know where the marijuana come from, but it was developed. Oh. It was developed. When I say they don't, the purchaser doesn't know the origin of the marijuana. They don't know what happened to it in the process of growing it and packaging it. What is your research on the impact on the sexual organs?
It diminishes the sexuality of black males. When you first start smoking weed, it's a magnificent turn on. All you want to do is lay up with the opposite sex or anything. You're a plastic doll, a rubber doll. But after a while, it depletes your sperm count, and it causes your sperm count to grow abnormally or shrink, meaning that they're destroying the next generation in the womb. Mm. In the womb, your offspring hasn't a fighting chance to be something when it's born. It would be born automatically with that dropout syndrome that the hippies had. The hippies didn't drop out. Now we see that Sesamelia, LSD, and other things helped them. I don't care where you go in North America, and our neighborhood, it looked like it's in the 1890s or below. We don't have any modern communities except for what we call the black wealthy or the black middle class. Our youth today has lost the initiative to be combative for their own success. They don't have that anymore. They rather sing or buck dance. They're not combative. I watched a robot program. Accidentally, I was surfing the tubes. It wasn't a black child in about 200 children.
Yeah.
And I beg your pardon?
No, I'm saying, yeah, it's robotics. Getting into working robotics, is that what you're referring to?
That's exactly what I'm referring to. They even had robots that can play basketball.
The fact is, it's very interesting you raised that. There's a school right here in Harlem. We had the guest on one time, and a sister at that school said the robotics team in that school right here in Harlem on 141st Street and at Frederick Douglass Boulevard, that's 8th Avenue, and the so-called Success Academy is taking up space in that school, which is an issue. In any way, they have pushed out the robotics team that was among the top three in the city in their particular category. This is a black community. So when we see robotics, That just came to mind, you know, where you haven't, you don't see our people, and they're not aggressive. You use the term combative. I think you may be referring to the term aggressive in terms of showing initiative in going after things.
Exactly, sir.
Now, how do people make contact with you, dear brother?
Well, my number is 212-686. 1970. Can I have one more minute?
Yeah, you got that.
Okay. Many doctors also fear that marijuana smoked by children, especially teenage males, can stunt their growth and cause a delay in puberty. Columbia University conducted a study on the impact of cannabis on the male reproductive organs. 16 healthy males were given 5 to 15 joints to smoke daily for 4 weeks. After the men stopped smoking, their sperm count was down and many cells were abnormally shaped, meaning that they were abnormally developed and they're used to bring in new life after the species, after the ethnicity. In other words, they want us to start off behind the eight ball if we are successful to come out of the womb from other biological, chemical, and biological, chemical, and germ vaccinations that they force or trick the parent to take before the baby is even taken home.
Now,
in other words, we've got to look and see what time we're living in and what must be done to us as a people. Regardless of my religion, how I wear my hair or my pants, we've got to unite and do something for ourselves, even if we still suffer from the Willie Lynch syndrome and hate each other for no reason, brother.
Brother Robert, what, very quickly, what qualifies you to speak on drugs?
Well, I've been an addict for 43 years. And I found some mistakes in the CASAC book, Chemically Addiction and Substance Abuse Counselor. I've been an addict. I've been an addict far as I can remember. I mean, it's not funny.
No. But the fact is, now listen. What brought you out of it? Because you're not an addict now. What brought you out of it?
Oh, the Nation of Islam, brother.
How?
By giving me the skills and the information on myself. They say once you really find out about self, you'll do something for self. See, the God is within us, and we are all gods with a little G. So once you find out the little G is active in you, as Minister Farrakhan teach us, you'll start doing better for yourself. Mm. It's no, you can't beat the devil at his own game. You have to have something totally opposite in what he gives us. How you going to trick me? And I'm a master trick knowledge.
Hold on, Brother Robert. Let me make sure this is... God bless you.
God bless you, my brother. Peace and love.
Peace and love. Hold on.
Okay,
hold on.
Take your time.
Hold on. No. I'm letting Brother Robert go. He's our resident expert on drug use. Because, Robert, tell him how long you was into drug addiction.
43 years, brother.
How long?
43.
Wow.
So
I know drugs was mad at you when you stopped.
When
the brother,
you don't want to stop. I don't care if you're sleeping in a shoebox.
Yeah, when the thugs come in to get you, they just said, leave him alone. We have to guarantee the bank that we have to have X amount of customers guaranteed for life.
All right, so we let Brother Robert go. Thank you, Brother Robert.
Thank you, and congratulations, brother.
As-salamu alaykum.
Wa alaykum salam. Brother Dick Gregory, God bless you. Thank you for joining us on The Communicators.
It's my pleasure. And just sitting looking at all the news, the Kentucky Derby. Now, do you know Blacksmith, right? And to the young folks, that's the ones that fixes horses' shoes and stuff, you know. And here's the universe made horses born just with what they got, and then we're going to put some shoes on them.
Mm.
And Blacksmith in Kentucky make more than a brain surgeon.
Mm.
That's a horse state. You know, we hear the Kentucky Derby.
Mm.
150,000 people in the stands come in from all over the world for 2 minutes, man. 2 minutes.
Mm.
Now they have other races, but people come in for the Derby, and that is 2 minutes.
Mm.
And so I used to work with some rich folks' horses on nutrition.
Yes.
And, you know, all my life I heard them, you know, the horse had to take a drug test after it was over and all of that. So I thought they was drugging the horses so they could win. They drugging the horses because they in so much pain.
Mm.
They heart and all that. To kill the pain.
Mm.
And so you keep saying, well, where is the Humane Society? Huh? Mm. I mean, if I know that, you know, they have to know that, you know. Mm. And so, but if you've never been to Kentucky Derby, you owe that to yourself. And you can sit in the expensive seats or sit on the grass. If you're down on the grass, you bump into folks you was in kindergarten with. You didn't even know they're still alive.
Dick, share with us real quick that story you told about collecting the tickets.
Oh, we was little youngsters, me and my partner Skeezik. We had a racetrack outside of St. Louis, Colloquial Downs, but that was in East St. Louis, about 30 miles from us, right? And so we would all, every night, a guy and his wife who owned the number one black restaurant in St. Louis, they would go every night, man. And so we would hitch a ride with them, and then we'd leave them. And then we'd go to where the rich white folks hung out. And after it was over, they throw their tickets away, you know, if they didn't win. And they got them $100 tickets, man. So me and Skeezy, we go pick up the tickets and kind of put them in a bag and wipe them off. And then we'd take them in a guy. We had a guy named Sal. If you wanted to be a newspaper boy, which we were, well, you'd go get your newspapers from him at 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock in the morning. And so we would bring our tickets, racetrack tickets, the losers, to Sal. Because just like folks in New York that play the lottery.
Yes.
Well, if you hit, you got to pay tax. So you also, if I got to pay you for my winnings, you got to let me write off my losing. A lot of people not aware of that. Mm. And so consequently, we would take him to Sal. And he would give us like 10 cents on a ticket that was back, you know, that was back in old days.
Mm-hmm.
You hear people say, yeah, back in the old days when a penny was a penny ain't never been nothing but a penny. I don't even want to hear y'all talk that old philosophy. A penny is a penny. Okay, and the only thing you could get for a penny was stuff that they know would hurt you. Penny candy. Cookie, anything. Mm. Anything you could get for a penny would hurt you. So anyway, we'd go to Sal, and then he would sell it to tax folks who did the rich folks' taxes.
Yes.
And he would give them X amount of tickets, and they'd get tickets from all over the country, man.
Mm.
And they would write that off on their income.
Mm. Well, Dick, what I would like to do, because we always have conversation between yourself and I, mm-hmm. and the audience doesn't have a chance to plug in and they always want to know what you're thinking, and I don't cover all those bases. So with your permission, I'll give the number out, and then they can call in with their questions to the point, and you can give your answers.
That'd be good.
All right.
That'd be good.
And somebody calling already, Dick. I ain't even give out no number. But I'm gonna say this before I pick up.
Internal Revenue call. Hey, yeah, no, do right. I still do that?
I'm gonna give out this number now. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, this is not the number to call in. Dick is going to be on Blog Talk Radio tonight or later on at 4 p.m. Eastern time. And the Blog Talk show is We All Be Radio. We All Be Radio. It's a Blog Talk show. They come on at 4 p.m. Those of you who do not have internet, you can call in and listen by phone, and you can call in, ask questions, etc. The telephone number is 646-652-4593. That's at 4 o'clock tonight. 646-652-4593. Dick will be on for 2 hours with Brother Ron in Memphis, Tennessee. And the telephone number here is 212-650-6903. 212-650-6903. Thank you for your call. You're on the Black Air.
Hi, how are you,
God
Brother
bless
Leroy?
You and the family, man.
I just
thank
wanted
you
to say basically that I saw Dick Gregory on TV One, and you know, if black folks don't know what freedom is, they need to watch that special, because he's been a free man all of his life. And I wanted to congratulate you, Mr. Gregory, and just let you know that I love you. That's all I wanted to
thank
say.
Thank you much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
All
thank
right.
And all family. Right. Yeah, that was Unsung Heroes. That's Kathy Hughes, TV One, and I have never been on this planet now for 82 years this year, and I've never known the research that they put into that piece. You know, when I'm watching me, I forgot that I was one of the keynote speakers at the March on Washington. I didn't know that till watching that, because, you know, you're doing so much stuff tomorrow. You think about something else, the next day you think about something else, you know. And it's all fun. You know, you know you're going to die. I mean, you don't want to. You ain't putting that wish on you. But you get to the point, if I have to die to do this, then, hey, bring it to me.
All right. We're going to the next call. God bless you in the air.
Yes, Brother Leroy. Thank you. And Baba Dick.
Thank you, my brother.
I wanted to ask the Ancient One there, he mentioned before that if you took navy beans and crushed them and mixed them with water, you could drink that as a nourishing nourishment with the minerals and everything. Could you just ask him to, you know, go over that?
Yeah, well, that's what Elijah Muhammad was talking about. If you log into the Senate or the Congress, you notice on their menu. Now, once I started talking about it, they took it off the menu. It said, by act of Congress, we must have navy bean soup every day. So Richmond was a congressman from New York.
Yeah, he was right here on the west side.
Billionaire.
Yeah.
The only billionaire in Congress. And we were real good friends. And I asked him, you know, why you all have to have navy beans? He said, oh, come on, that's that. So I said, okay, let's go to lunch today. So we go into the Congressional Dining Hall, and there it is. By act of Congress, we must have navy bean soup every day. He said, oh, they don't mean that. I said, wait a minute. I mean, you here? And you don't know this is a law? And so he came back the next day, and he said, I'm sorry, man, it is. Now, here's what it is. There's going to be a hell of a tragedy that's going to hit. As the sun is going to explode. It explodes every 13,000 years, right? And so there's been some debate about when is the 13,000 year come up. A woman get pregnant, she explodes every 9 months. The elephant get pregnant, he explodes every 7 years. So the sun. So the Aztecs, that's why a lot of people said the world was coming to end 2 years ago.
But they sit around and they forgot to factor in leap year. And so now there's books coming out now. They say, well, we know it's going to happen between this time and this time. And the only way you would survive, and this is what Elijah Muhammad talked about, is navy beans. So I get to looking at it, and I said, navy beans. Well, why is it called navy beans? But why are we talking about Adam Powell? Sometimes I think you all in New York don't know who you had, because this man, all your social legislation, not just in America, but they thought about writing on the planet, that come out of Powell, Adam Powell. That come out of his preacher brain, that come out of his intelligent brain. And when Adam got to Congress, he went into the congressional dining hall, and a Negro couldn't go in there. A congressman couldn't go in there. So he told Adam, he says, you know, colored can't come in here. He said, I'm a congressman. I don't care who you are, you can't come in here. He said, but the Negroes who's in Congress, they go to one of the better Negro restaurants in D.C. And he said, it's about 3 miles from here. You can take a cab. And he told him where it was. He said, and you'll enjoy it. So Paul was, thank you very much. And Paul left, and he came back. He went into the ghetto and found him a 6'7" ghetto Negro. Big, tall, strong, dirty hands, dirty face. And he brought him back with him. And so he's getting ready to go into the congressional dining hall, and the white guy said, hey, didn't I tell you you can't eat in here? Oh, that's what you were saying. I thought you said I couldn't eat in here by myself. I thought you said if it's Negroes, you have to have two. So I brought my friend, and you better get out the way, boy, because I'm doing what I thought I heard you say. That was Adam Powell. That was Adam Powell. And so what it is now, that navy beans is called navy beans because it's the only food you can put on a ship that a rat can't eat. So that's what I'm saying. I wonder what that means. And then I found out that just like your hair grow every day, well, a rat and a mouse teeth grow every day. And those of you all who have lived around them, whether it's in your house, like when I grew up, you hear them, we just thought they was gnawing a hole.
Right.
No, they was filing their teeth down, because with their teeth going every day, if they didn't file them down, they would choke to death. And so right now, a rat teeth is stronger than a gorilla, a hippopotamus, and a rhinoceros. Okay? And they're strong because of that. Now, so that means they rat can eat through steel, wood, anything, but they can't eat through a navy bean. And so that's, and we put, when I found this out in, I guess, 73, we put navy beans away, and we still have them. Okay? So, but now, you can't cook them now. People say cook them. Let me tell you something. From fasting, when you go X amount of time from out eating, you can smell food 20 miles away. So don't cook them. You have people. And if you tell your brother, your sister, and your mom and them, that and they say you crazy, you tell them, you know I'm right, because once hunger sits in and they know, oh, Choco got some food, they're going to come get it, man. And you remember that plane that crashed up in the Andes?
Yeah.
And they started eating one another.
Yeah.
It was friends, man.
Yeah.
So when I moved to the farm, two of my children had a job. Every week they had to dig like a new grave.
Yes.
In case the people, see, we live around white folks, right? In case they came down to see how we doing and see us looking healthy and stuff, then they know you got some food. So we say, hey, Ed, man, thank you, man, for coming down. Y'all okay? Say, yeah. I said, but we have a problem here because all the food is messed up and people are starving. And so we let people live here on the farm, but you just have to have, you must know that when you die here,
Now, we can feed you, but when you die here, you got to be willing to let us eat you. And then I would point to the fresh grave and say, yeah, we lost Ed the other day. Boy, did he taste good. Let me tell you, it never happened, but they would leave. Let me tell you, they would have left there and went and told all the folks, do not go down to the Gregory place. They're crazy. Okay? And so, but that's what it is. Now, let me tell you, when you crush him up with a hammer, okay, and turn him into powder, you drink that with water. In India, they do it with their urine.
Mm.
But, so anyway, you drink it, and it gives you 20 of the 21 amino acids.
Mm.
And once you get the 20, the body will manufacture the 21st.
Mm. Telephone number 212-650-6903. We're on the line with Brother Dick Gregory, and it's your show.
Can I say one thing to the brother that's listening?
Yes, sir.
And everybody else, there's a book that came out when I was a little boy called The Good Earth in a movie about the famine in China.
Yeah.
And these guys see this smoke coming out her stack, and they rush over there, man, and say, she must be cooking something. And they get in there, and she got this pot on the stove. It's a real story. And they reach for the pot. They're hungry so fast, the pot falls on the floor and found out she was cooking dirt.
Oh, man.
That's, no, wait, no, no, wait a minute. Listen to this. That's why it's called the good earth. So if you plant a cucumber seed in your backyard and a turnip seed, right?
Go ahead.
The cucumber will grow and the turnip will grow, right? So whatever triggers that seed is in the dirt.
Oh.
And if we knew, now there are some black folks, maybe some white folks too, but I know some black folks that know how far they got to go down and get the dirt and cook it and eat it.
Okay.
Okay? Now, you remember when you was a little boy, them old black folks, especially the women, would go eat dirt?
Yeah.
Eat dirt and starch, remember?
Yeah.
And because it's something that triggers whatever you got out of that. It's in the dirt. And you cannot be frightened. You cannot be scared. Okay? Fear and the universe don't run together. You can't be scared. And like, again, I say, you tell somebody, you know, that, and they'll say you're crazy until all at once say, you know, he a genius. He knew what he's talking about. Do you have his address? So anyway, thank you, bro.
All right. Caller, you're on the air.
Yes, sir. Peace and blessings. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
I'd like to ask Brother Gregory.
Peace to you, my brother, and the family. God bless.
Yes, thank you, sir. Likewise to yours. I want to know, what do you think about this European situation around the Red and Black Sea, United States over there, where all that wheat and all that muck, all that oil that floats on top of the water that Russia doesn't have a refinery for, an American industry.
Yeah, well, let me tell you something. You can do this here. Tell my brother Leroy to do it to punch up the contract, $1 billion contract, that the Russians sold, signed with France to build them a navy. Hmm? All right, see, they're trying to get back up to their peace now, right? Now, the problem with two of the mighty cities in America is San Diego and Norfolk, Virginia. That's where the two greatest Navy forces hang out because of the open sea. So they build their own ships right there, except Groton, Connecticut. That's where they build the atomic subs. It's in Groton, Connecticut. By the way, about 98% of all your guns and ammunition come out of Connecticut, okay? Now, we think it's just a little place where rich white folks escape to on the weekend. we think that the biggest money that Connecticut get comes from insurance company. No, 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 no. They even make the Saturday night guns, Saturday night hit, all of that, and then they ship them to the other states and let them sell them. And so, consequently, but all your other ships is made either at Norfolk, Virginia, or California, San Diego. Now, I tell you this to say this. The Russians don't have that facility, okay? So if you're building
ships for me, how you going to get them to me? Okay? Those two cities they fighting over opens into the Black Sea. That's where the delivery's coming. Huh? Mm. And that's why you if once you plug in, you'll see about the contract. But why you think you haven't heard France say anything, and why you think that if they up the boycott, France ain't about to mess up their contract. Plus, when I got a peep at the contract the other day, it said if you renege in any way, you got a penalty to pay.
The contract is, what I pulled up is Mistral, Mistral.
Uh-huh.
France may cancel Mistral warship contract for Russia, and that's dated March 17. So that's where it's mentioned.
Yeah, well, let me say this. Don't give up on that. Let me say this. Why you have to hear that from me when you got a New York Times there? You hear me? Why you have to hear that from me? If the New York Times, you think I know something they don't know? And so again, I'm saying, you know, that's what they have. They have a clause in their contract, okay? You renege on this, you owe us big bucks.
That's in another story. France will have to pay Russia over, and they have a European sign for billion.
You what white folks used to call 100 years ago a smart Negro. You see, and then the ones that didn't understand it, they say, he prophesied. Those are Negroes say that. He prophesied. Did you hear what he said?
It's a two, according to what they have here, it's a $1.2 billion contract.
Yeah.
According to what they have here.
Yeah. Well, the one I looked at was trillions.
Okay, hold on. God bless you on the black ear.
Thank you, Brother Leroy. My mother years ago told me about people down in Alabama eating dirt, and PBS did a special about it. They had all of these European scientists in a room trying to figure out why are these people down there eating dirt. And they went down there and found out what Dick Gregory was saying, that it was full of nutrients.
Yeah,
because the plants use it to grow, so why can't people
But eat let me slow up and go over it again. If you put a carrot and a turnip in your garden, right?
Go ahead.
So the carrot seeds will grow carrots, and turnip seeds will grow turnip.
Right.
But wait a minute. So evidently it's something in the dirt, and this pulls it. This pulls it. But the folks that know it, I can bypass. I can bypass that and go, how many layers down do I have to go? Okay? And so, yeah, so I didn't know that, but you should let my brother Leroy know about the PBS and let him look into it, because it'll be nice. Well, I don't know. Y'all going to get some dirt in New York.
Oh, well, we have time for one more. God bless you in the black ear.
Brother Barry, what's up?
Excellent. God bless you, my brother.
Brother Gregory,
Bless you and the family.
It has to do with a legal matter.
I'm sorry.
I know that...
Brother Barry?
I didn't hear what you said.
Brother Barry, repeat your question.
Okay, the question is about a legal issue, about the education of law in the schools, and how come that has not... No one has talked about that.
Tell me what he just said.
Education, law, or... I'm not clear, Brother Barry.
There was supposed to, in the New York State Constitution, it stated that we were supposed to have been educated in law from 6th to 12th grade. How come the one is not talking about that?
Oh, well, that's white supremacy, man. Well, that's the thing, but let me hear. You have any children?
I got one daughter.
All right, let's say you got five, okay? All right? And the law says, the truancy law said, if they're not in school by a certain age, the parents can go to jail. You aware of that?
Yes, sir, I am.
All right. Now, let's say if three of them starve to death, you don't go to jail, man. They take the others and put them in foster homes. Since when is there a bigger penalty, from not putting a child in school than three of them starving to death? This is a game. Once I get you into school, you learn what I want you to learn, That's what that game is about. It's like they telling us now, that 50% of all young black teenage men, high school, drop out. Then the question is,
than when y'all started laying off teachers.
Mm.
If I'm selling pork chops and I'm selling 10,000 a week and I lose half my customers, then I don't need but 5,000. Huh? When you do it, you find out it's 11% dropping out, okay? Not 50%. And so, again, I say that's the whole school system. And then you know it's something wrong with the school system when you just said what you said, you know, what they have to do, and then they got to depend on lottery tickets, they got to depend on gambling to keep the schools open.
Mm.
And the other thing, the law thing, why is New York have the roughest, and most folks found out about it when the late John Kennedy, when he flunked the New York law test four times. The reason is New York is the only state in America you don't never have to have gone to school. If you never went to grade school, high school, and college, all you have to do is pass the bar exam.
Exactly.
You know, and so that's. But if you get to looking, you see a lot of stuff is hidden. A lot of stuff is hidden and corrupt. We sitting here now after the basketball debacle. We're talking about that thug in New York who bought the Washington Redskins. Okay, and so when you stop and think about, go way back to the Washington Redskins. You know, the hottest two franchises in America was the Dallas. Dallas was who? The Dallas what?
Cowboys.
Cowboys and Indians.
Right. Dick, on that note, we are concluding this one, but we remind the audience that you're on Blog Talk Radio tonight.
Okay, and we'll talk about that basketball thing, because how come they didn't tell us in this latest thing that his son was found dead? Okay?
Whoa.
And they think it was a drug overdose. Even if it wasn't, with all the press that's coming out, huh?
Wait, what happened?
His son was found dead in his home in Malibu, in 2013. Now, with all this news we've read, how come we didn't see that? Hmm?
Well,
what is this about? And then also, he's 22 years old, Scott Sterling, and a year before that, he had a fight in the father's house where he shot her. He shot the guy. And they ain't prosecuted him yet. And here's what the investigators say. They say it might have been a drug overdose. Come on, man. I mean, that's your job when you perform the autopsy. It might have been a drug overdose. Give me a break.
Brother Dick, we're at the black end. I want to thank you. And for folks who want to hear, I'll give the number after I let you go. God bless you, my brother.
Thank you.
Peace
and love.
And that telephone number tonight at 4 p.m. if you want to hear Dick Gregory or plug into the Blog Talk show, We All Be Radio Blog Talk show, 646-652-4593, 646-652-4593. And remember, Serena and Venus's father is going to be here in New York Wednesday at the Barnes & Noble on 82nd Street and Broadway at 7 p.m. Richard Williams, book signing.
You're listening to WHCR 90.3 FM, The Voice of Harlem.
The Educational Theater Program at the City College of New York proudly presents the 2014 Family Arts Day, Saturday, May 10th from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. Family Arts Day offers free fun for everyone. There will be theater games, face painting, puppets, sing-alongs, clowns and mask making, live performances, and much more. That's Family Arts Day, Saturday, May 10th from 10 a.m.